Welcome. Today we will review pelvic inflammatory disease. Our objective today will be to briefly review the definition, epidemiology, and pathogenesis of pelvic inflammatory disease, which I will refer to as PID in this presentation. We'll review the important long-term sequelae associated with PID that makes it such a public health concern. We will also discuss diagnosis and first-line treatment for PID. Here is an outline of the presentation today. Pelvic inflammatory disease is a spectrum of inflammatory disorders of the upper female genital tract, which includes the uterus, fallopian tubes, and ovaries. It is believed to be caused by ascending spread of microorganisms from the vagina to the cervix, endometrium, fallopian tubes, and/or adjacent structures. The rate of PID in the United States population has gone down over the last 10 to 20 years. Most likely, this is due to the use of prophylactic antibiotics prior to surgical procedures, routine screening of high-risk populations for sexually transmitted infection, and to the use of antibiotics early in patients in which lower genital infection, such as cervicitis, is suspected. PID is a polymicrobial infection. The most common bacteria isolated in cases of PID are anaerobic bacteria, chlamydia, trachomatis, and Neisseria gonorrhea. Certain high-risk populations should be watched closely for evidence of PID. In particular, sexually active young women, patients attending sexually transmitted disease clinics, and patients who live in other settings where there are high rates of gonorrhea or chlamydia are at risk. A clinical diagnosis of symptomatic PID has a positive predictive value of 65 and 90% compared with laparoscopy, which is thought to be the gold standard for diagnosis based on early studies. Today, the diagnosis of PID is primarily made using this clinical criteria. Of note, the diagnosis of PID requires ruling out other causes of abdominal pain, such as appendicitis, ectopic pregnancy, or other surgical emergencies. Treatment should be initiated if patients have at least one of the minimum criteria listed here, which are cervical motion tenderness, uterine, or adnexal tenderness. Further workup for alternative etiology of pain should not delay treatment. According to the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, other criteria that may increase your specificity for the diagnosis of PID include fever, mucopurulent vaginal discharge, numerous white blood cells on a wet mount, and or detection of gonorrhea or chlamydia. The most specific tests for diagnosis include endometrial biopsy, ultrasound evidence of tubo-ovarian abscess, and or diagnostic laparoscopy. However, due to the increased risk of long-term morbidity associated with failing to treat a patient with PID, it is recommended that a high level of clinical suspicion be maintained and that patients with minimum criteria be empirically treated early. In the short term, treatment is aimed at clinical and microbiologic cure. This can be reliably achieved with antibiotic regimens, as described on the next few slides. Less is known about the effect of current regimens on long-term outcomes. However, it is thought that by early detection and treatment of PID, it is possible to decrease the rates of infertility, ectopic pregnancy, recurrent infection, and chronic pelvic pain that can be the long-term sequelae. Certain patients are candidates for outpatient treatment in the setting of PID, and there does not appear to be any benefit of inpatient over outpatient therapy if they meet criteria for outpatient management. Appropriate regimen should empirically cover gonorrhea and chlamydia. If the clinical picture is concerning for anaerobic infection, for instance, if bacterial vaginosis is detected, then consideration may be given to adding an antibiotic with broader anaerobic coverage, such as metronidazole. Certain populations will require closer monitoring and inpatient parenteral therapy. These include patients who are pregnant, those in whom a surgical emergency may be suspected, such as appendicitis, patients who have not responded to oral medications, or are unable to tolerate outpatient oral regimen, those who demonstrate other signs of severe illness or have radiologic findings concerning for a tubo-ovarian abscess. Per the Center for Disease Control, the recommended first-line treatment includes a cephalosporin with broader anaerobic coverage, such as cefotetan or cefoxitin, with doxycycline for a total of 14 days. After clinical symptoms improve, patients may continue doxycycline with or without metronidazole for a total of 14 days. There are many alternatives to this regimen, and there's limited evidence that any regimen is better than the other. Whether patients are treated as inpatients or outpatients, the patient should be followed closely, and clinical improvement should be seen within 3 days of initiation of therapy. Repeat testing and completion of screening for any sexually transmitted diseases within 3 to 6 months should be performed. Patients with pelvic inflammatory disease are at high risk of recurrence. All patients diagnosed with gonorrhea and/or chlamydia should also have testing and treatment of their sexual partners. In summary, pelvic inflammatory disease is a polymicrobial disease with significant public health implications, including increased risk of ectopic pregnancy, infertility, and chronic pelvic pain. Early detection and effective treatment is required to decrease long-term sequelae. Evidence suggests that outpatient oral therapy is equally effective for treatment of mild to moderate PID as inpatient parenteral therapy in certain clinical situations. It is very important to remember to screen for other sexually transmitted diseases in patients diagnosed with PID and their partners. Here are my key references. Here are acknowledgements. Thank you.